As you see the news, for those of you who have any interest in the news, am I still on? As you have any interest in the news, much of it isn't worth knowing, worth watching. But you know, we see that the world is we're on that exponential curve, aren't we, heading for the abyss. And it's kind of heartbreaking and scary on the one hand, and pretty exciting on the other hand, because through all these trials and challenges and everything, it really opens up more opportunities for the light to shine and people to be open to receiving the gospel of Jesus Christ. And that excites me. I don't know if any of you know about Chick-fil-A, if you follow Chick-fil-A at all. If you go to Chick-fil-A, they have finally one in Maine, in Bangor. They put there a couple of years ago. Great organization. Dad was a devout Christian man. They never open their stores on Sundays, you know. They still don't. Man, they are under all kinds of scrutiny and persecution, and they're trying to, you know, get their stores in these big cities and on campuses and everything, and they're constantly turned away because of their views on marriage, among other things, you know. And they're in the hot seat, but they don't apologize for what they believe, and that Jesus Christ is the Son of God, and you know, and that there's a right way and a wrong way to live life, a way that's best for us, that God designed for us. And you know what? They're prospering. Even in the midst, they don't attack or retaliate. They just keep on doing their work with excellence to whomever will come into their store, their restaurant. Do you know they're the fifth largest restaurant chain in the world? Isn't that crazy? They're in sales, in annual sales, they're number three. They're ahead of Wendy's and Burger King. It's just an amazing thing to me. And they're not open on Sundays. They only operate 6 days a week. Isn't that beautiful? So that's encouraging to me, to just stay the course and hang to the rigging. Doesn't matter what anybody else thinks or says. You know who you belong to. You know why you believe, hopefully. And God will prosper you. Just like Hezekiah, you know, where he listened to the Lord. He trusted the Lord. He obeyed the Lord. He was loyal to the Lord. And what did God do? God allowed him to enjoy his presence always, and he succeeded in everything he did. I like that. Lord, help me. And it doesn't matter what we do, and success isn't, you know, how much money you have or the size of your home and the number of cars and so forth, et cetera. That's not how God measures success. We all know that. But I was just thinking of those things this morning, and, you know, as we're going through the book of Philippians and just looking at the life of Paul and Timothy and you know, the things that Paul is teaching us here through the Word of God and by his Holy Spirit, I love that, and I love how God works. I, you know, was looking here in the bulletin today, and grace and peace, keys to church unity. Our brother Corey is bringing us a message today for the sermon, and I love that from Philippians chapter 4. Hey, this is the book we're in, you know. God is doing something, and he wants us to hear. He wants us to apply his word to our lives in a real, tangible way, not just come to church and that's the thing we do and there's the end all. It's the foundation that God uses to train us up to go outside and be Jesus to the world around us. Isn't that it? Isn't that why we're here? That's why I'm here. You know, if this wasn't the purpose of bringing you and me to a greater understanding of the word of the Lord that we can apply it to our lives, I mean, there'd be no point in it, really, other than just, you know, we like it. But how does that change the world? So just some additional thoughts that I was having this morning. I thought I'd just hopefully encourage you in that. Let's pray. Father, we're here this morning knowing that the greatest thing to ever happen in the history of the world is Jesus Christ, who came down that we might go up, who lived and died for our salvation. And Lord, secondly, your church, the body of Christ, that you work in and through to reveal to the world around us your truth, your love. We're always holding out a hand, come to Papa. And Lord, we pray that you help us in our understanding today for truly living a life of faith. Help us to understand what it means to be thankful, to be in your word, how to enjoy unstoppable joy. So speak to us this morning, Lord, by your Spirit, through your word. In Jesus' name we pray, amen. We all want peace. The world prays for peace. Interestingly, the world fights for peace. You know, we pray for this. We fight for it. We demand it. The world holds peace accords. The world has peace treaties and all of that sort of thing. And even if peace could be achieved long term, which it can't, it most certainly would only be man's peace, thus leaving much to be desired. And ultimately, as we see, peace treaties are broken almost without exception at some point in time. So, you know, whatever peace man can achieve is ever fleeting, if not just super shallow. As we were ending up last week, as Paul was addressing the church at Philippi through this letter, he said, grace to you and peace. We talked about that. Grace, what, do you remember the Greek word for grace? Some, charis. That's a beautiful word. And some people, some gals have actually that name. I know, as I shared with you, a family whose daughter's name is Charis, and the other's name is Truth, Aletheia. Paul is saying, by putting shalom, the peace of God, and an inner joy and a stillness in the midst of chaos, he puts this after charis. Charis, grace means what? God's riches at Christ's expense, unmerited favor. God loves us unconditionally, right? We don't earn it. And so this is a beautiful thing, but Paul puts peace after it because why? Why is Paul saying grace to you and peace? Why does he put it in that order? Do you recall? What is it we need to know first before we can have the peace of God? Salvation, the grace of God, the unearned love, the unconditional love of the Lord. I need to know God loves me before and really embrace that grace before I can really begin to know the peace of God. Peace, shalom in the Hebrew, is the fruit of really a gracious activity in the experience of sinners. You stop and think about God's grace lavished on you, and you know just who you are. You know how you are, right? I mean, nobody is as intimately acquainted with you as you are, and maybe your spouse comes a good second. But God knows us, and He knows everything about us, and yet He still loves us. Isn't that awesome? I mean, that's just incredible to me. And I can have peace now because I know that. So grace to you and peace. Paul writes, Romans chapter 5, if you turn there to verse 1, this is one of the first little passages, these first five verses in Romans 5 that I took to memory many, many years ago. We're just going to read verse 1. Romans 5, 1. If someone would like to read that for us nice and loud, that would be great. Okay, thank you, Scott. Okay, so therefore, What do we think of when that word therefore is there? What is it there for? It all the previous things Paul was saying, and he comes here, he goes, therefore, hey, guys, you have been justified by faith. What does justified mean? Anyone? What's a good way to remember what justified means, like in this context? Just as if I'd never sinned. I like that. And that's good to remember, because when we sin, the enemy of our souls and our own struggles with ourselves, you know, we want to beat ourselves up when we fail, you know, when we fall on our lips. But hey, you've been justified by faith. So now you can have what with God? Peace, right? Shalom. Irene in the Greek. Listen, where does this peace come from? Where does this grace and peace come from? Okay, the Holy Spirit. When Paul says grace to you and peace, he states that this grace and peace comes from God the Father and our Lord Jesus Christ. He's not saying, hey, I'm passing on my grace and peace to you guys. No, he's saying it's from God. This grace and peace is from God. He's the one that gives this. And he's addressing, and he's did this about every letter he wrote. Grace and peace in that order to you. And we talked a little bit last week about that grace, you know, and saying have a wonderful eternity instead of, hey, have a great day. You know, we say charis, you know, say grace and peace to you. Have the peace of God. Be settled in your soul. And every hello is a goodbye, and every goodbye, hello. And it's all from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. Why does he not include the Holy Spirit here with the Father and the Son? Because we have the Trinity, right? God the Father, God the Son, God the Holy Spirit. Why do you suppose, what do you think about when you say, oh, well, why isn't he mentioning the Holy Spirit here too? Why isn't he saying from God our Father and our Lord Jesus Christ and in the Holy Spirit? Okay, can you say that again, Scott Louder?
The Holy Spirit is part of us.
Okay. Did you hear that?
Yep.
Holy Spirit, so we already have the Holy Spirit. He's already in Philippi. He's living in every believer, yes.
And those are fruit of the Spirit. Love, joy, peace.
Amen. Galatians 5:22. Absolutely. So, you know, the Holy Spirit's already indwelling the believers, and, you know, we have the Father, Son, and the Holy Spirit. Of course, Paul believed that. And so, verse 3, Philippians 1, I thank my God upon every remembrance of you. Yes? Sure. Right, it's all about relationship. Of course, the whole book, from cover to cover, is about relationship. And, you know, we've talked about that with the Ten Commandments, and, you know, when Jesus was confronted by the Pharisees on, hey, you know, they're trying to trip him up, and they said, what's the greatest of the commandments, you know? What did Jesus say? Yeah, love God with every fiber of your being, basically, as he's saying, right? All that you are, put your all into loving the Lord, and then he said, "What? Yeah, and these two are one. You know, the first four verses, the first four commandments, and the Ten Commandments are about our relationship with God, and the other six are about our relationships with one another. So it's our relationship to and with God, and to and with one another. This is the life." When we have the fruit of the Spirit growing in us, we have the Holy Spirit in us. This is possible, and I love how God works all these things together, and he's showing this through the pen of Paul. Timothy probably, as we said, was scribing this for him, was writing it down as Paul dictated. But here is, you know, I thank my God upon every remembrance of you. think about the love, the sweetness. There's got to be a really deep-rooted relationship here. Paul had not only with God, but with him, with the believers at Philippi, right? And so he's addressing them. Man, I thank God for you. You know, all my remembrance of you causes me to thank God. I like how Eugene Peterson puts it in The Message. Every time you cross my mind, I break out in shouts of thanks to God. And you think about, here's a pastor, you know, a guy who planted the church. And so he has a history with these people, and he loves them. Now, we'll talk about this in a little bit, but all that history wasn't necessarily filled with great memories, you know, and experiences. But every time you cross my mind, I break out in shouts of thanks to God. Just, you know, imagine Paul. He had plenty of time on his hands, and he's mentioning Philippi here, thanking God for the believers, and you know, in prison there while he's writing this letter. And I don't know if you've ever done this as you looked back in life upon certain experiences and all that, but I can imagine Paul thinking about these believers, you know, that God used him to bring to the saving grace and knowledge of Jesus Christ and planted this church. And maybe, you know, in his absence, maybe like even Pastor Leonard is thinking about his congregation here today, and he's thinking about each individual and where you sit, you know. He knows, he just pictures you, you're in your place, because everybody has their favorite place to sit, pretty much. You know, there are a few that like to move around and connect with other people and stuff like that. We do that through our greeting part here, but Paul is probably thinking about them, seeing their little faces in his mind's eye, and you know, Lydia and the slave girl that was demon possessed once, and you know, the jailer and his family and all that, and you know, they some are listening with great expectation. You know, they have wide open eyes and they're really hungry to hear the word of God and hanging on every word, soaking it all in. There are those who kind of, he was thinking, maybe they just kind of look off into space and they're pondering what's being said, and you know, they're just maybe not seeming like they're engaged, but they're there. And then there are those who are fidgeters. They kind of are always moving around in their seat and stuff, and they're playing with their devices or whatever. And then there are the dozers. There are always dozers, you know, especially when you have a voice like mine that has a tendency to, like, put people to sleep, because I hear it's very soothing. I don't know. I can't hear it, but I've been told that before as they go, oh, sorry. But anyway, so he's thinking about it and loving each one of them, you know, just vicariously there as he's sitting in this prison and he's remembering these people. And he's just got this joy in his heart, and, you know, he says, I thank my God upon every remembrance of you. And, you know, he's maybe wondering how life's going with them and all that, and, you know, the trials that they're going through and how they're growing in grace and all that, and that intimacy with the Lord. I spent more than a quarter of a century, that sounds like a lot, 25 years, it's a lot, quarter of a century, I'm still such a young guy, in Christian radio. God saw fit to pull me into Christian radio. I'm not going to get into all of that and you know, how that happened, but most of my experience was in non-commercial, non-profit radio. So like public radio, public television, we had to raise our funds. You know, we couldn't have commercials as you know them, like you hear on The Bear or, you know, one of these other stations, whatever station you listen to. Commercial, even commercial Christian, they can run commercials, but non-coms can't. They have to do what's called an underwriting announcement, which often can be done in a way that don't sound much different, but it's the languaging that's really the key. Can't say certain things, you know, you can't say quantitative and qualitative, any kinds of descriptions like that. You can't, you know, do laundry lists of services or products and all that sort of thing. You can't say, you can't give calls to action. Hey, they're having a sale. Call now, you know, go there. You can't say, you have to language around all of that. And if you really listen closely, if you listen to non-commercial Christian radio, Maybe you'll can kind of just listen carefully and you'll notice that. I like it when the Christian radio stations keep that sort of thing to a minimum, and I'm sure you do too. But it is a way to raise funds for the station, because it does cost money to operate the station. And during these pledge drives or these share-a-thons, we would tell stories. We would tell stories about the lives of listeners who had called in or written in or put on a Facebook post or something about how God is working in their lives and the challenges that they've had before listening. We'd share that, and then we'd share how God has been using the station to help them to really grow and become good Christians and get back to church and all that sort of thing. Good things. Talking about how the music and the announcers are helping them to live the life and so forth. Also, the Christian radio station will use scripture to encourage and motivate people to give. And we see, you know, in scripture there are places where Paul encourages others, you to give. We see the first really fundraiser back in Exodus 25 there in the first few verses where God tells Moses, go out and ask people who want to, you know, that have it in their heart, that want to give to the work of the Lord. So, anyway. What if you received an appeal letter in the mail from a Christian radio station or some other Christian organization opening with, I thank my God upon every remembrance of you? And it, you know, wow, that makes you feel kind of good, you know? Man, these people are thinking of me. They're saying, we thank God as we remember you and all of that. But wait a minute. They don't know me. I don't know the person, if I'm writing this letter, that's going to be reading that. Most likely, I might know a handful from meeting them or serving with them, but I likely don't know them. They certainly don't know me per se. But if I get that letter, I'm thinking, well, you don't really know me. But what are they preparing you for? Not to give. The ask is going to come. You know, problem, solution. How you can get involved? Ask. Okay? So, is Paul doing that here? No. He isn't writing this, you know, I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, to appeal to their emotions or to motivate them to give to him. Although we do see that he's thankful as we get further in to the word, that, you know, he's thankful for the support that the church has given him over the years. And so I'm just thinking, you know, as Christians, even, you know, I mean, pastors can say this because they pastor the flock, you know, God has given them and all that. Corey understands this as a pastor, you know, and being responsible for teaching others and loving on them and so forth, that there's an affection that develops. And, you know, Paul had this for these people at Philippi because he was part of their lives there at the beginning. And so I, you know, upon every remembrance of you, I'm just thanking God for you. And I love you. And, you know, man, I miss you. I can't be there with you. You know, so we know Pastor Leonard is probably be thinking that right now. Janita and their away can't probably wait to get back to their family and, of course, to their church family here. And so I think it's important for us to, as we think about what Paul is, where he's at, maybe how you might be thinking in a similar situation, and just reminiscing and so forth. Do we have our own memories, remembrances of other brothers and sisters like that in our lives, that God has used us to maybe be a spiritual father or mother to them, you know, sharing the gospel and then discipling them and bringing them up? God wants us to have those. How unfortunate, how much we're missing if we don't have them. You know, mentoring, all these things, you know, passing on life to these souls. We talked about the family business a little bit last week, right? So you all have your business, right? You're involved. You got a job. Maybe you own a company or something. It's your business. But and we are part of a business. We're part of a family business, right? What's our business? Proclaiming the gospel. An article in Forbes magazine back in July of 2013 talked about businesses in America and family businesses, and that family business in America is responsible for 50% of the gross national product. Family business. Now, you know, when we think family business, we're thinking of a little storefront or the guy down the street that has his own little, auto shop at maybe garage off his home. We know a guy like that out in Corinth, a couple of guys that, you know, they have their family business like that. But, you know, the article goes on to say that Walmart is a family business. Ford Motor Company is a family business. Tyson Foods is a family business. And the list goes on. Sears, Comcast, or Sears, almost no business now. What's interesting, though, with those family businesses, the same article noted that less than one-third of those businesses, those family businesses, survive the transition from the first generation to the second, and of those that survive the transition to the second, 50% of them don't survive the transition from the second to the third generation. And why is that? Why do they fail, do you suppose? God's plan for the family, okay. I think of Blockbuster. Does anybody know the Blockbuster story and what happened to them and why they didn't survive the transition to digital? They didn't do it. They sat on their hands. They didn't think it was important to get into the digital arena with movies and stuff. And along comes Netflix of the world and so forth and just puts them out of business. Redbox, well, I don't know how much longer they'll last. Because it's becoming less and less a convenience to go get your movie, even though it'll cost you a buck, buck and a half, and then you got to go take it back. But they get stuck doing things the same way. You just get stuck doing things the same way. And so the business outgrows their business model, their structure. They don't change it. We're in the family business. We're in a partnership with God, right? Remember that fellowship? What's the Greek word for that? I like that word, koinonia. Kind of a cool word, just like how it sounds. Anyway, means we're in partnership. We're in a joint venture together. And that's our family business with God, with the Lord, and with others. And we have a product. The product is what? Salvation, okay. Anybody else?
Discipleship,
okay. What's our main product? What's the product that we're selling? Huh? The gospel. Bingo. Hey. Yeah, the gospel and all the things that come out of that. What is the gospel? What does that mean? Good news, okay. Great, what a class. Man, you guys are on the ball here. I love it. This is all stuff we should know anyway, right? We all know this. Okay. Am I loud enough? Do I fade out too much? Because I can't hear myself. Well, I mean, I hear myself here, but I don't hear it anywhere else. You okay? All right. So the gospel is our product. It's what we give out. We don't sell it. We give it. Give it away. We give the good news away. We disseminate it. We broadcast it. That broadcast, you know, you think of radio and TV and all that. When you hear the word broadcast, what does broadcast mean? Spreading it out. We broadcast the seed of life, you know. And we share the gospel. Always sharing. In verse 5, you notice, for your fellowship in the gospel. Fellowship in the gospel. Verse 7 talks about the defense and the confirmation of the gospel. And in verse 12, Paul speaks of the furtherance of the gospel. These first few verses we're focusing on here through verse 11 ultimately is basically covering the point of our fellowship in the gospel. We have this fellowship, we have this partnership, right? And we fellowship together and we break bread. So fellowship for us covers a lot of things, but when you think of fellowship here, think of that. We're partnering together with the Lord and with others, with one another, to the furtherance of the gospel. And so this is our product. Why is the gospel, the good news, our product? Because Jesus told us to do it. Anything else? Think about what the gospel does. What does the gospel do? A lifesaver sets the captives free. Okay, good. Yeah, reconciles us to the Father. What happened to Paul on the road to Damascus? Well, he was Saul then. What happened to him on the road to Damascus? I like that. From the he was changed. It changed his life. He was transformed from the persecutor to the persecuted, the preacher. If a preacher's doing his job, he's going to be persecuted. Speaking the truth in love, boldness, confidence in the gospel. There's going to be persecution. So he was changed. The gospel is the only thing that can change a life. This is why the gospel is our product. Isn't that cool? So you have something. You don't have to sell it. You just give it away. Life change comes from the gospel. How did this come about? You know, we're thinking of, you know, Paul, and he knew about Jesus, and, you know, he was chasing after followers of Christ, and what was he doing? He in his zealousness for God, right? He was persecuting Christians, hammering on them, making life miserable for them, having them beaten, having him thrown in jail, having him killed.
Came about as a result of God's love for his created ones.
Came about out of God's love for all he created. And he expressed this love how? Yeah. You know, you see all these football games and events and stuff, people holding up 316. God so loved the world that he gave. And so Paul experienced this, Saul experienced this as a result of the gospel, the good news that what Jesus did on the cross, and that's how we get from earth to heaven. Is via that, the price that Christ paid, he did the heavy lifting, you know. And we can trust that he died, he was buried, he rose again, he ascended into heaven, and there he is preparing a place for each of us. So I can get rid of this carcass, this broken down tent that dogs me, and be in my eternal home, my mansion. And so Paul's life was changed. You're a Christian. Your life was changed. Like Paul, you heard it. You received it. And here you are. Timothy, he heard it. He received it. Lydia heard it, received it. The demon-possessed girl that was dogging him heard it, received it. The jailer heard it, received it. You see it? So faith comes by, and hearing by the Word of God. And Jesus is the Word of God, the Logos. So, wow. You know, so we're fast-forwarding back from the planting of the church, about 10 years or so. Paul's in jail. And, you know, he's thinking, man, there's a church there all because of the gospel. There are church members. You know, you got the family business going and growing, and it's a beautiful thing. The gospel is continuing to go out. Let's jump into we're going to read 3-8, but we'll back up so in context we can look at verses 1 and 2 again. We'll just read these 8 verses here in context, and I'll go ahead and read those for you. But you can follow along, whatever version you have. I'm reading from the New King James. Paul and Timothy, bondservants of Jesus Christ, to all the saints in Christ Jesus who are in Philippi, with the bishops and deacons, grace to you and peace from God our Father and the Lord Jesus Christ. I thank my God upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine, making request for you all with joy. For your fellowship in the gospel from the first day until now, being confident of this very thing, that he who has begun a work in you, this good work in you, will complete it until the day of Christ Jesus, just as it is right here for me to think this of you all, because I have you in my heart, inasmuch as both in my chains and in the defense and confirmation of the gospel, you all are partakers with me of grace. For God is my witness how greatly I long for you all with the affection of Jesus Christ. So, in these verses here, 3-8, we find three partnership principles, right? We are in partnership with the gospel, in fellowship with the gospel, right? We've got that established. We all are getting that. That's kind of sticking now. And so we can see these three partnerships thing here. Can you see what they are in these verses? Number one, what do we see Paul being? What is Paul expressing? Gratitude. Okay? Paul's thankful. So the first partnership principle is being thankful. And we're always to be thankful in everything, Paul writes in Thessalonians. Why? Because this is God's will for you in Christ Jesus. And so be thankful. And then number two, what is he showing us here with this second principle? Is confident. Be confident. So be thankful, be confident, and he says, be aware. So that's what we're discovering here in these verses. To be thankful, to be confident, to be aware. Hey, can we say those together? We need to be thankful, be confident, be aware. Okay? Thankfulness, confidence, awareness. All right? So Paul is getting, he wants us to soak this into our souls. So we're thankful, we're confident, and we're aware, just like he is. So we'll begin with thankful and being thankful for God's work collectively, all the things that God is doing. We are thankful as a fellowship of believers. And he says, I thank my God, verse 3, upon every remembrance of you, always in every prayer of mine, making requests for you all with joy for your fellowship. There's that koinonia again, for your partnership in the gospel from the first day until now. So, where is Paul writing this from? Jail. He's in a prison cell. Where have we established this? Most likely it's Rome, okay? And we'll see that as we go through Philippians some more, why we believe that. So that's all been established. He's in his prison cell, got a lot of time on his hands. So we talked about he's reminiscing, he's making this inventory of memories, he's going through all of this, and You know, like you and I would likely do if we were sitting in there with nothing else better to do. You know, we're hopefully, you know, we're not dwelling on the negatives, but we're gonna be in this heart of, hey, count your blessings one by one, right? Instead of counting sheep, as the old song goes from what movie? White Christmas, Bing Crosby. Count your blessings. Instead of counting sheep, count your blessings. And one of those memories, of course, obviously, was about the church at Philippi. So here we are. I put a smile on my face when I think of you and remember you in prayer, he is likely saying. You know, this is basically what he's saying here. Wow, it just blesses my socks off as I think about you and I pray for you. I thank my God there in verse 3. And then we see in verse 4, joy. Now, let's be honest. If it were you sitting there in that jail, would you be thinking these things? Would you be thankful and filled with joy and remembering these people and writing a letter like this? Not likely. I don't think I would. My brain wouldn't go there, you know. At least not at first. Because when you think about, I like digging deep here because I want to, what's going on here? What it would have been like if I were there? I want to be transformed. My prayer is that you are transformed. So try to think like Paul here for a minute or two. Was Philippi a really great experience for Paul originally? No. I mean, Paul, first of all, he didn't want to go there. He had his sight on Asia, right? He had no desire to go there. He ends up in Troas, and what does God give him there? He gives him a vision, remember? He gives him a vision from Acts 16 of a man from Macedonia, which is where Philippi is, a major city, right? Okay, so he has his vision, and God is basically telling him, hey, go to Macedonia. So he goes, and after you've had this vision and you get to Philippi, what are you likely going to first be doing? You're going to be looking for something. What? Probably going to be looking for some guy. You know, God gave you this vision of a man in Macedonia, so you probably got your radar on and you're, hey, is it you? You probably would recognize him if it, you know, oh, there you are, you know. There'd just be that connection. You ever have that connection when you meet another real believer and there's this kindred spirit going on? It's like, wow, I know you. I've never met you before, but I know you. I love that when the Lord does that. Don't you? Isn't that great? But so, no, he ends up, because there's no synagogue, he ends up, we've been through this story, but he ends up down by the river, and what happens there? There's a prayer meeting going on, right? Of some believers in God. Right. They were believers of God, but they hadn't heard the good news yet. So Paul's down there, and so what does Paul do? He's got the family business, you know, that's being established, and so he gives away his product, the gospel. And what happens? A woman is saved. Hey, first convert. All right. Well, we've got one. You know? Woo. Well, it's not the guy I thought it was going to be. But anyway, so, hey, we got a convert. Yahoo! And it's a woman. Okay. So, a few days later, Paul and Timothy and them, they're moving about. And, they're sharing the good news and all that. And they run across this. You remember the story? This slave girl, you know, that's making all kind of money for these guys because she's demon possessed, and so she knows certain things and helping these guys, you know, take advantage of the population and making all kinds of money and stuff off of her. And so she starts following him around, and you remember what she does, right? What does she do? She starts mocking them and, well, you know, you listen to these guys, you might get saved and so forth, etc. And she wasn't saying it in a endearing way, I'm sure, just very mockingly and all of that. And, you know, eventually, like me, I mean, this is like a dripping faucet, you know, I don't know if I would have, I just was, get out of here, you know. But what does Paul do? He preaches the gospel to her, and what happens? She gets saved. So here's, okay, we got another one. And then as a result of that, Paul, you know, and Timothy, they get hauled off right into town, into the town square, and they start getting beaten, right? They're getting flogged. Man, this rod, these rods are striking them, you know. You might maybe don't know the word. It's called vitis, V-I-T-I-S, vitis, which is the main vine of the grape vine, and they're about 3 feet long. The Roman centurions would carry these around, and they used them to motivate their lazy soldiers and such, you know. And actually, it was the badge of the centurion who was over 100, and, you know, keeping everybody in line and on task, doing what they're supposed to do. And this vitus was the emblem for the badge for these guys and the stick that they carried. And so this is what happened to Paul. You know, he's beaten with these rods and put in jail. There's a commentator, Alinsky fellow, that says what this would have felt like. He says, under the many blows, the skin would be broken, the blood would ooze out, the inflamed welts would cover the whole back. And so Paul received the full brunt of the vitus. You know, so I'm in this jail in Rome, and I'm thinking about Philippi, and that's probably one of the first things that's really sticking out in the forefront of my mind. I'm getting beaten to death for preaching the gospel, practically, and then I'm thrown in jail. That's pretty exciting, man. I tell you what, I can't wait to go back. Have you had experiences in life like that where, you know, you just have had mistreatment? You've been wronged. You've been wounded deeply. Maybe you've been abused in some fashion or another. We see a lot of people who've been abused coming forward all these years later, and they're still harboring these things. You don't see them remembering the good things in life. All of this bad stuff is coming out, and yet Paul says, interestingly enough, with all of this background, I thank my God upon every remembrance of you. So, you know, I probably wouldn't have written that. Yeah, I tell you, I've been in ministry for many, many years. God chose to allow me to be part of Christian radio for a quarter of a century. I've served in churches in varying capacities over the years. And I have to say, it's been among my least favorite experiences and some of my greatest experiences. You know, it's the worst of times, the worst of experiences, and the best of experiences, because the body of Christ is made up of people. People are referred to in the Bible as, and sheep do what? Huh? They're stinky. They're unruly in a lot of ways. They kind of like to do their own thing and wander off. They don't like to listen too much, only to the voice that they know for sure. But sheep bite too, you know. And it does not feel good. And so I've had some of these experiences, painful things. And I think, if I'm to be honest with you, if I may, that I have received more grace and kindness and respect working in the secular arena of business than I have in church business. yet Paul says, I thank my God upon every remembrance of you. Through all your pain, through all your challenges, through all your heartaches, through all the disappointments, all the letdowns, all the stinky things that people have done or the things they haven't done, they should have done, through all of these things, can you be thankful because God's grace has been at work? God's grace has been at work. The Holy Spirit working in the heart and life of a believer. We call that a work of grace. Grace. God's grace. Amazing grace. So I want to be that person, and God is helping me to be this person as the Holy Spirit is helping me to be able to push the delete key of all those bad memories. Yeah, I still remember the things, but I don't dwell on them, and I don't, the details aren't there. And none of that matters because the Lord is helping me as I bring every thought into captivity to the obedience of Christ. 2 Corinthians 10:5, the Lord is helping me to push the delete key, and I can remember all those things that God is doing in the midst, in spite of and despite all that heartache and pain and disappointment and stuff. That is liberating. This is Paul here. I remember, I had a tough time there. I didn't want to go there and all that, but look what God has done in the midst of all of that. And so through persecution and through beatings and imprisonments and all that and shipwrecks and stuff like that, Paul, his mind isn't focused on the bad things and all of that, on the stuff that happened to him, the injustices, the wounds, the hurt, none of that. He's not saying, oh, let me tell you about how these people are. He's not doing anything like that. He's saying, I thank my God upon every remembrance of you. Thank you. God was working. God was working, and Paul is saying, I have joy. So Paul was thankful for what? Paul was thankful for what?
What he remembers of death.
What he remembers of this body in Philippi that has been going and growing. He is thankful for the family business and the product that has been delivered, right? The product being the gospel and what the gospel produced. The gospel, see, if I can remember this, I'm going to be more impassioned and more likely to be ready to share this, to give it away to those whom I see and meet and work with and come in contact with, become friends with. I'm going to share the gospel because the gospel produces life change, right? Life change. Has your life been changed? Has your life really been changed? Yeah, we know God, we love it. God loves you. We say, oh, God loves you, 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 God loves you. But can you say, I really love God? I really love God enough. I love him so much that I'm, no matter what the consequences, I'm going to work in the family business and I'm going to give away our product regularly. I'm going to encourage and inspire others to and believers and non-believers in a way to come to the Lord, you know, out of my relationship with him and the joy the Lord has given me and the delete key. I'm no longer, you know, going around looking like someone who doesn't really believe they're going to heaven. The memories brought great joy to Paul. Yes, he was hurt. There was pain. But the gospel changed people's lives through it all. In verse 12, he says, but I want you to know, brethren, that the things which have happened to me, now you know, he's speaking about his incarcerations, imprisonments, unjustly accused, and so forth. He says, the things that have happened to me have actually turned out for the furtherance of what? The furtherance of the gospel. So it doesn't matter what good things or bad things are happening to you. But the point is this. God has an objective, and he wants to use you for it, and this is for the furtherance of the gospel. Did you have something, Joanna?
Well, he's praying for them, and they're probably praying for him.
Sure, of course. There was this great relationship that they had. And they loved Paul, and as we know, and we'll learn more, they were giving to Paul for the furtherance of the gospel. And for this, he is grateful too. So the life-changing element's going out. People are being saved. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord, for all of this. I'm joyful for this. Thank you, Father. So, brothers and sisters, as you step out of these four walls today after Pastor Corey brings a great word of grace and peace and the unity of the church from Philippians chapter 4, that you remember your family business and your product and be ready for the Lord to use you to give that away. And who knows what will happen as a result. We know that there's the potential for lives to be changed. Let's pray. Father, thank you for your Holy Spirit that lives in us. Thank you for your word. Thank you for the truth. Thank you for our family business, this koinonia we have with you, this fellowship with you and with one another, this partnership we have in the furtherance of the gospel and spreading the gospel, the good news that there is life eternal and life enjoyed for all who will come. We thank you that you love the world so much that you gave your one and only Son, that whoever will believe on him will not perish but have everlasting life. May we be instruments, vessels for you to continue to further the family business this week. In Jesus' name we pray. Amen.